for the delay. So I want to give a talk on Scilab, introduction to Scilab. In fact, there is a subtitle also, use Scilab, not MATLAB. The outline of my talk is as follows. So we have 3.5 hours. So what we have is, I'll give a talk, an overview of Scilab and some of the work that we have been doing to support people, to help people who want to migrate to Scilab. What help is available from our group, that I want to explain. Why it is important, overview of Scilab, what help we can provide, how you can interact with us, and some resources that we have already created. These are the things I would like to talk about. First of all, I want to say a few words about free and open source software. Scilab is FOSS, or free and open source software. Why we should switch to FOSS, that's the first thing. The commercial software is expensive. Many of us in academic institutions may not realize that, because, you know, for example, all the students in IIT Bombay may have access to Scilab, okay? It could be the same situation in your own colleges also. But what happens when they leave your college? What happens when the students graduate and go to the industry? Can they continue to do what they were doing in colleges? So I have some stories. There is the story from Italy. Let me start with that. A multinational company was raided once for the use of illegal software. So some inspectors came, they raided the one illegal copy of Microsoft Office. Okay, they found one illegal copy of Microsoft Office. So there was going to be a court case. They came up with an out of court settlement. What was the out of court settlement? That company should count the number of machines it had, number of machines, number of PCs in Rome, in that building, in Rome, in Italy, in Europe, all over the world. Count the total number of machines, multiply by per copy cost of Microsoft Office. So that had to be paid as damages if there had to be no court case. And the damages came to how much? It came to $20 million for having used one illegal copy of Microsoft Office. The damages came to $20 million. That was a problem. Then I was teaching this, CS672, I think, at IIT Bombay. There is a course called Embedded Systems, taught by Professor Kavi Arya and Kriti Ramamritam. And I used to teach the controls part of it. And one year I was teaching Scilab, and I told people how I would use Scilab for data acquisition and control, real-time data access. There were 25 students in the class, mainly MTech and PhD students in computer science. So I asked the students, how many of them had used Scilab? In the class I asked, how many used Scilab? Out of the 25 students, only one raised his hand. So I scolded him, why did you use Scilab? Looks like everybody uses MATLAB, why did you use Scilab? So his answer was, he was working for an embedded systems company before joining for higher studies. After BE, he went and joined an embedded systems company.
Hello, 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 hello.
Right? Rent a small office space, go and bid for projects, complete the project, supply it, get the money. So they typically do one or two projects at a time. If you look at the turnover, if they can survive, that is good enough. Right? So this fellow, who joined IIT Bombay later, wanted to use MATLAB. He went and told his boss, please give me MATLAB. Okay? His boss told him a copy of MATLAB would cost 2 crore. A copy of MATLAB would cost 2 crore for the company. It is not 5 lakh, it is not 10,000 rupees, it is not 50,000 rupees, it is not few lakhs, it is 2 crore, because the point is that along with the embedded systems, you also have to send the executable file, right? You have to produce the image, you have to compile it, you want to have rights to distribute as many as you want. So with all this, a copy of MATLAB becomes very expensive. For so his boss told him, you can use C, you can use assembly, you can use whatever, but no MATLAB, we can't afford it. If you use, if you still insist on MATLAB, please resign and go, we don't want you. We can't afford it. In fact, I was telling this story to Mumbai University faculty members, organized by, that meeting was organized by Professor Kavi Arya in the robotics group. I told the same story, and his project manager then came to me. He told me that he had a similar story. He also had a small startup, and they were coming up with a product that would help search videos based on emotions. Okay. So it required, obviously it required some signal processing, Fourier transform, data mining and things like that. And they gave their project to some faculty member in Pune, and that person had done it. They gave the algorithm, that person finished, it was working beautifully. Then they found that in order to launch it, they needed some special license of MATLAB, because that faculty member had also used MATLAB. And then he, this person, project manager of Professor Kavi Arya, came and told me, he then found out that it would cost 1.5 crore. So they apparently asked the faculty member, professor, please, why did he use that? Cost 1.5 crore, we don't have. So the professor apparently asked these guys, but you have venture funds, 10 crore. 10 crores have been given to your company to, you know, why don't you pay 1.5 crore out of that? So this guy said, sorry, it is not for that. Venture funds are not for that. Okay. So these guys then went about creating the whole thing, redoing the whole thing in some open source software, but before they could finish, Google came up with the same product. In fact, it was too late. They had to, in fact, close down the shop. They closed their company down, and then he joined as a project manager in Kavi Arya's lab. So it is important for us to realize that when we go out, the facilities that we enjoy within the colleges, college premises, are no longer available. If you want your students, okay, to be entrepreneurs, they should start using open source software. Some of the commercial software packages are extremely expensive, and any illegal use will land them in a lot of trouble. So that's why this slide is extremely important. One of the most important slides in my talk, there is no alternative to open source software, okay, especially for small and medium scale enterprises, and we would want many of our students to become entrepreneurs. Okay. So Scilab is a good substitute for MATLAB. It has about 95% compatibility. What is Scilab? It is free and open source software. It is easy to use, and it has excellent computational environment, LINPACK, ISPACK, LOPACK, same as MATLAB. But being open source, it can also have access to all open source software packages, some of which may not be ported to commercial software packages, because the licensing of open source software may be such that you cannot use it in a commercial, provided your software is free, you can use it. So those software packages are not available in MATLAB, but available in Scilab. Scilab is created for mathematicians. Okay. For example, you can create a matrix, you can create a vector, have a matrix called A, have a vector called X, A star X. So you don't have to write for loop, you don't have to keep track of indices and so on. It belongs to MATLAB family. It belongs to MATLAB family, originally created by Professor Clive Moeller, who had worked on LINPACK and ISPACK projects. Okay. So here is the history of Scilab. Original MATLAB was created, original MATLAB, not the MATLAB that is available now. Original MATLAB was written in Fortran. It was available as open source software. In fact, when I was in the US, I myself had downloaded that and compiled it on my PC80 and ran it. Okay. Then the moment that idea came, two companies started, two products came, Matrix X and Control C. After they became very popular, then Professor Kleemuller said, hey, I made a mistake in releasing it as open source. He also resigned from University of Utah. He started his company MathWorks and then rewrote the entire MATLAB. Okay. But all these things came from the same original Fortran thing, Fortran, which came out of an NSF project, which is funded by the government, it was available openly. A lot of people started using it. So Scilab is one of them. Okay. So Scilab is used extensively for linear algebra, simulation, control system design, and so on. Other features, you can call programs written in Fortran C. It has good graphics capability. It has a very large installed base. Lot of algorithms implemented in interpreted languages as well. So Scilab.org is a web page, and Scilab.in is our website. We are supporting that Scilab.in. How reliable is Scilab? First thing people will say, you might have heard people saying, oh, Scilab has a lot of bugs. It crashes, don't use Scilab. Have you heard that? Has anybody told? Scilab has bugs, don't use it. So the answer is, so here is the talk given by Mr. T. Martin of CNES. Does anyone know what CNES is? Okay, CNES is a French acronym. It is equivalent of, CNES is an equivalent of ISRO. They launch Ariane rockets. Have you heard of Ariane rockets? Ariane rockets place many of our satellites. Our GSAT was placed by Ariane rockets. In fact, whenever we had problems with the US or their facilities were not available, always went to France. They always launched our satellites. Senior manager of CNES, Terry Martin, talked about use of Scilab for space mission analysis and flight dynamics activities. In fact, so it is now widely used in CNES, various engineering fields, telecommunication, RF analysis, navigation, attitude control system analysis, and dot, 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 lots of, okay. So this, if you just do Terry Martin, and if you just say on the internet, you will come across this file. He gave this talk in the first ever user conference on Scilab that was held in 2009 on July 1st in France, and I was the chief guest. And then I talked about the National Mission on Education through ICT in that conference. Then he gave this talk, and I was chairing that session. At the end of the talk, I asked him, Mr. Martin, it looks like you are using Scilab for everything. Don't you use anything else? Don't you use anything else? So if CNES can launch their Ariane rockets using analysis done through Scilab and place our satellites, okay? So Scilab is very good. Don't even have any doubts. Don't even have any doubts. If somebody comes and says Scilab doesn't work, please don't believe them. They have a vested interest. That is why they say that. Okay. Okay. Of course, MATLAB, IIT Bombay made a policy, institute policy, in the early 2000 that we would not buy MATLAB for campus-wide license. We still have a campus-wide license, but it is for Scilab version 6.0. You know, that came many years ago. Okay. We have in fact decided not to buy. We use Scilab. Okay. Now I want to give a brief overview of Scilab. So that is all story of Scilab, just to as an introductory kind of thing. Now I'll show some uses of Scilab. It can be used as a simple calculator. So 4 plus 6 plus 6 plus 12, so 22. See that? So the way I have written this, created this file is my commands are in black, the answer given by Scilab is in blue. Can somebody see here, only A and C are displayed, B is not echoed. Can you say why? Okay, B has, after 6 I put a semicolon. So if you put a semicolon, it will not display. So if you say, for example, A equals 4, it will display, but if I say A equals 5 semicolon, it will say okay, it won't display, but if I want to see what it is, type A, it will say it is 5. Okay. So semicolon is used to regulate the output. So here are some commands. So what I have done is x is 1 by root 2 square root of 2 by 2, which is 0.707. And then arc sine x of, that is sine inverse of y, is 0.785 radians. You multiply this by 180 divided by pi, you will get degrees. So pi is denoted by percent pi. Okay, let us see that. Okay, percent pi is this. So for example, square root of 2, right? A sine square root of 2 divided by 2. So what will this be? This will be this multiplied by 180 divided by percent pi, 45 degrees. So you can do all this calculation very easily. By the way, how many people have used MATLAB here? Okay. So fine, about half the people have used MATLAB. So this overview will give an idea of what Scilab is even for other people. Okay. So those of you who have used MATLAB, please bear with me, because you will find this, or at least you can compare everyone. Okay. How does it work in MATLAB? So percent is not there in MATLAB, you just have to say pi. There are some minor differences. Okay. So here what I have done is A equals 1 through 5. So I have created a vector 1 through 5. And I can also say something like B equals 1 is to 2 is to 9. 1 to 9 in increments of, right? And then of course I can do something like C equals A B, we'll append. Okay, because this is how we do in mathematics. If you recall, Kleemuller was a mathematician, numerical analyst. He said, when I teach on the class, in the class, I write in the board, I just write A star B. Why, when I go to computer, I have to do a for loop and all that? Let me create the environment. That is how this MATLAB came up, right. Now, what will this be? B of 1 is to 2 is to 5. What will this give? B of 1 is to 2 is to 5. What is 1 is to 2 is to 5? Yeah, it will be 1, 3, 5. So, what will this be? No, B of 1, 2, 5, what is that? To find out what it is, 1 is to 2 is to 5 is 1, 3, 5. What is B of this? B of 1, B of 3, B of 5, right? B of 1, 1 is to 3 is to 5, okay. Is it okay? B is that, B of 1 is to 5 is 2 is to 5, you can see that what I wanted to say is, in Scilab you require very few number of instructions, okay. It's a you know, in fact I say often that Scilab is to C is like C is to assembly, If assembly language requires 100 lines, C would require 10 lines. If C requires 10 lines, Scilab would require only one line. Okay, high level language. Okay, let's come back here. This is what I have. B a 1:2:5, and then B a 101. That is what this is. And then you can do things like A minus 2. So, for example, A is this. What is meant by A minus 2 or A minus 1? A is a vector, 2 is a number. Because mathematics people, when they write, what do they say? A minus 2, subtract 2 from every element. Okay. That it knows. Okay. A star B. It will say inconsistent multiplication because A is this, B is this. Okay. So, but I can do things like A plus B, I can say. Okay. So, it knows that if it is a vector, so for example, A minus 2, it subtracted a scalar from every entry, but when I add two vectors, if the length is equal, if the operation is consistent, then it just go ahead and does that. Okay. Component wise, dot star you can do. So, component wise it will do. Of course, you know, Scilab has this nice feature called dot star A dot star B. Dot star means multiply component wise. Component wise, yeah, it is a dot product. It is not, I do not have to say dot product because I can do it for A dot slash B. It is not dot product. That means do it element wise. In fact, I can say A raised to the power B, dot raised to the power B. That means take every element, raise it to the power B. Okay. So, it has nothing to do with dot product. Okay. So, 5 to the power 9 is 1953125. Okay. All right. So, that means all these operations are overloaded. They have vector to vector, vector scalar, scalar scalar. So, it depends on the context. Okay, I have done some more multiplications. It has logical operators, equal to, less than, greater than, less than or equal to, and so on. Look at this. A is 1 to 9, B is 9 minus A. I get A is something, B is something else. Okay, do you follow that? First two lines are okay. These two are okay. Now, what does this command do? TF equals A equal equal B. Okay, the question is why is it not going up to 9? Actually, the width of the screen is too small. So, let us do this. 1 through 9, A equals 1 through 9, B equals 9 minus A. Okay. Then I ask this command TF equals A equal equal B. What is it going to do? What are we doing by A equal equal B? What are we doing? We are comparing two vectors. I am checking whether vector A is equal to vector B. What kind of answer is expected? It is a vector going to be compared. So, what it does is it does element wise comparison. So, in this case, what is the answer? All false, right. So, of course, you can do something like A greater than B. Where is A greater than B? From here onwards, from fifth onwards. Yeah, it will say how many false first? 4 false. 4 false, the last 5 will be true. By the way, in Scilab, the indexing starts from 1. If you have a vector A, you will start with A1, okay? Because it turned out that at that time, most of the numerical computations were being implemented through Fortran. And in Fortran, the index starts with 1. C still had not become popular. If they had been using C, then they would have started with 0. Of course, most of this MATLAB, even now, you know, all, you know, uses the starting index as 1, even though it has been completely rewritten in C. Okay? So this is something that you have to remember. So this is okay. Four F's and 5 truths. So A is this, sorry. Locate is, let me just see, find A greater than 2. Okay. So you can actually do things like that. In fact, what I have done here is I have used this command called find. So find of A greater than 2. That means go to location, go to A, search everywhere and give me where this happens. So it says it happens from index 3, 4, 5. Actually, this is not okay. Let's do the same thing for B. Yeah, let's do this for B. 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, find B greater than, let me do 7, just to, does not give 9, it gives the index, it tells you where it is, then you can do this, B of, find, that is right, B greater than 7. Find the index where this is greater, go to that element and get that for me. That is also correct. You want to go back. It gives the indexes only where this is satisfied. It says from third onwards. That example was confusing because the element values also happen to be the same as index. So that is why I did not want to use that example. A is greater than B, that is okay. Here.
In this case, 4 number of elements are not the same. There are 6, there are 8.
If it is not equal, then it will not agree. It might say error. This is not, error. It will give an error message. It will give an error message. If it is a scalar, it will accept. Yeah. If it is a scalar, it will accept. But if these are vectors of different lengths, it may not work. But look at this last line. How many lines of C code you would have written to do this, right? So this is extremely important, for example, in image processing and so on, where you may want to detect an edge. The edge may be decided by some, you know, some pattern. So you can say that find that pattern, go and search, okay? It also turns out that Scilab has been written for vector arithmetic. I want to explain to you. If you do vector arithmetic, it is a lot faster compared to arithmetic. In which case, so for example, doing something like this is extremely nice. Not only should you do this, not only is it convenient, but it is also efficient. Okay, we will see that. Okay, you can take transpose. So, for example, here I have created a matrix. This is a way to create matrix. So, semicolon means go to the next line, 1, 2, 3, and then semicolon says go to the next line, 4, 5, 6, semicolon, 7, 8, 9. Then B, A of 3, 3 is 0. So, for example, we can do all of that. A equals 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Then A of 3, 3 is equal to 0. When I press return, what will happen? No. What will happen if I put a semicolon? What will happen if I do not put a semicolon and return? That is the question. If I put a semicolon, it will not display. But if I don't put a semicolon, what will it show? No, before that, what will it show? It will show the entire matrix. Even though you are putting only 3, 3, it will show the entire thing. So now you see why semicolon is important. You may have a 10 by 10 things, you may be doing a lot of calculation, and then if you don't put a semicolon, it will display it every time. Okay. So anyway, it displays that. You can calculate the determinant of that, you can calculate the eigenvalues, you can calculate the eigenvalues of this using this bad word spectrum. So here is eigenvalue, you can calculate the determinant. Sorry, you can do all of that, you can do all of that, because see, it uses the same library that MATLAB uses. In fact, the state of the art packages for doing eigenvalue calculations, computations, and then to solve linear equations, okay, these are done by a software package called LAPACK. LAPACK is the state of the art, there is nothing better than that. LAPACK, LAPACK, it is also available as C code, it is also available as Fortran code. It is the best. Scilab uses that. Scilab uses that. Okay. It's okay. Now you can do all these things. Look what I'm doing now. B is equal to A of 3:-1:1, 1:3. What will this do? So remember, A is a matrix, it has two dimensions, okay. You have x comma y or I comma j. So the first one refers to the rows, the second one indicates columns, just as we do in mathematics. Remember, this is written by Clive Moeller, a mathematician, creator for mathematicians. So rows comma columns. Column says 1:3. Take all columns 1:3. But rows it says start from 3, decrement it one at a time, go all the way up to 1. So what will it do? It will just give the rows in reverse. Okay, let's do that. This is A. So let's say B equals A of 3:-1:1, and then 1:3. Okay. Let's do it for column also. Let's do it for column, but let's do this. 1:2:3. What will it do? Okay. Okay, let's not do that. Yeah, first see this. Just see if you can understand this. Let's understand this. So what are we doing here? The rows, we start from third row. Remember, the first one is the third row of, yeah, third row, then :-1 means increment by -1. In other words, it becomes 3:2:1, right. In fact, to see it even more clearly, let me just do this. 3:-2:1, third row, and then the first row, yeah, second row is skipped. Okay, you follow this? Okay. So similarly, now I can play around with the column also. So I can say not 1:3, but I can say 1:2. It will give me first two. Okay. So Scilab is a high productivity software. In one line, you can mean a lot of things. Right? That's why I say that Scilab is to C is 10^1. You can express, highly expressive. Okay. Sometimes it crashes. Doesn't matter. Restart. That will be the best thing to do. But I'm not here to come and say please switch over to Linux. I'm not saying that. This is Linux. And I have it in MATLAB, in Mac, Apple. Unfortunately, it is not connecting. Otherwise, I would have shown it in my Apple. Of course, it runs on Windows. Okay. All right. Okay. Now these are all straightforward. It has random numbers. Okay. I told you about vector computation. So let me show you that it is better to do vector computation in Scilab. In fact, we will do that because I did this calculation somewhere else. So there is a command called timer in Scilab. It tells you the current time. Okay. So what we will do is we will create a to be equal to ones of 100,000 by 1. That means ones means, okay, first of all, what is ones? 5, 1. So if I say 1, 5, it will give me this. Ones means you create matrix of ones, all ones, that is all it says. So let's define A to be 100,000, 1, and remember to put semicolon. Otherwise, it will display all 100,000. Okay, this is A. I have created this. Right? Then we will do a calculation like this. For I equals, let me just see what the usage is. 100,000 B of I equals A of I plus A of I. Remember to put the semicolon. Then end. I put a for loop. I said 100,000, just do it. So once let it finish, then I will demonstrate the timer. So you can see it took a lot of time, right? Then let's say that anyway we can do that again. Timer like this. Then so, in any case, let me do it once more. Okay. Okay. Of course, it's a random number, but let's do the following. C equals A plus A. It is the same thing. What is the difference between B and C? Are they same? So what are we doing in C? C is A plus A. What is B? B is also A plus A. But only thing is it was done in a loop. So they are one and the same. So what we will do is we'll have to. Yeah, it gives some kind of a watch. So let's do it now like this. Timer timer. Yeah. So here of course it says that this is of the order of 0.432, this is the order of 0.16. So you can see that it is about 1/3 of the speed, but I have seen much better speeds. Now for example, I had done in the calculation that I did in my previous machine, I did this. First one came out to 0.31. So what is this? So, okay. So I did the timer first, 0.02. Then I said for loop, but I had done only 10,000, not 100,000 like we did now. I did the timer and I found answer to be 0.31. Then I said a plus a timer 0.03. So it came out to 1/10 the time. It required only 1/10 the time. So you would see this because of course looks like Scilab has kind of optimized. It says, hey, you already done this. I know the answer. I will not recompute. Okay, which is an improvement, which is nice, but the idea is that you should try to use vector calculation. That's why I say that go for vector computations. One can go through the demos. Okay. In fact, in Scilab there is here, I think is it here, Scilab demonstration. So for example, graphics, 2D and 3D plots. Okay, here it is. Right. So you can of course do lots of calculations. Let me just see. Z grid. Okay. I selected some subplot. So it's you can see all of that. Actually, the source is available in some subdirectory. If you can locate it, you can actually see the source also for this. Previous versions actually used to display the source, but somehow it doesn't happen. But you can see that there are lots of things: spreadsheet, parallel, toolbox. So when you have time, you can look at that. So let me close this. I think that's all I wanted to say. Okay. So comparing MATLAB and Scilab, capability comparison. Hey, MATLAB has all these toolboxes, Scilab doesn't have. So the thing that I would ask is this the correct question? Why? MATLAB has, MathWorks has 2000 employees. So every month they will produce a 0.1 version. Okay? They'll keep changing, it'll keep changing. They'll say, hey, something I have, great. But what is on the flip side? Who pays the salaries for the 2000 people? Us, you. Okay. So that is one. Whereas Scilab, although it has only 23 full-time employees, there could be 100,000 users. Everybody could create, contribute, and it could become a lot richer. In fact, I have some examples to that. You can do hardware interfacing through FOSS, Scilab. In fact, we have teams working on this at IIT Bombay, but I am not going to talk about it. We are using this software called Comedy, control and measurement device interface, which is a Linux project. It has drivers for more than 400 A2D cards, digital IO cards and so on. I have written 150, but it is actually more than 400. We can call all of them from Scilab, and if the devices are not in Comedy, but you have C drivers, you can embed them. Okay, I'll skip this. In fact, if you come to our lab, if you have time, Rupak here. Where is Rupak? Yeah, you can see Rupak. Rupak can actually show you. Raise your hand. Yeah, Rupak can demonstrate hardware interfacing of this single board heater system with Scilab. In case if some of you are interested in taking one for you, if you have enough, we can even give some, right? Okay, replacement for ARCAD that we are working on. Sage is a replacement for Mathematica. It's based on Python. One group is doing. OpenFOAM is replacement for Fluent. Okay. Now I want to talk about two specific projects we have on Scilab providing support. One is lab migration project. Suppose you are using MATLAB in your labs, undergraduate lab, and you want to migrate to Scilab. You give us your problem statement, we will give you the Scilab code. So that from July itself, we can switch over to Scilab in your labs this semester itself, coming semester. Okay? Is that okay? This is a lab migration project. Some of the examples are IIT Bombay, Delhi University, Shastra University, Anna University, and there are many more universities that have come forward and requested us to give. It could be a DSP course, signal processing course. It could be a, yeah. Yes, that's what I said. Using GNU radio, we are working on that. If you are interested, please come and talk to me. Yeah. We'll be more than delighted. We are working on LabVIEW replacement also. So for that, in fact, this is what I said. What we are, how many people use LabVIEW here? Okay, there are about 7-8 people. So for example, so Scilab for hardware interfacing, okay. This is one thing I said. Now GNU radio is an open source software. It uses C++ and Python. It can call OpenCV. It has nice graphic front end. It has sliders, etc. It allows change of parameters in real time. Some of these features are comparable to what LabVIEW has, but it can call Scilab. GNU radio can call Scilab. GNU radio can call XCOS. XCOS is like Simulink, which comes with Scilab. So it's very nice. And one of the problems when you use commercial software, for example, LabVIEW, and you have some other proprietary software, they may not talk to each other, right? LabVIEW may allow Simulink connection now. It may not allow this access after some time, or it might say that only some features of Simulink are accessible. For other features, I have comparable thing, better use mine. Because it's a proprietary thing, they would not, if somebody is threatening, they are not going to give connection to that. Whereas when you have open source software, there was absolutely no problem. In fact, we were using LabVIEW for virtual labs, and at that time LabVIEW didn't have associated script. Everything had to be done through block diagram. So if you have two signals, you want to add the two signals, you have to put two blocks and an adder and take it out. So my student said, you know, I want to write a Kalman filter. How do I do it using block diagrams? It will take forever. So she just talked to our students doing M.Tech in computer science, did the whole thing in, she did the whole thing in Scilab. Of course, if it worked, all right. She made Scilab to work with Java and to work in the virtual labs environment. In fact, that also Rupa can demonstrate. Now, in fact, he has implemented the whole thing in Python, right? If those of you are interested in using Scilab for hardware access, Rupa can demonstrate later. We have not come prepared for that, but it is, we have a working system in our lab. So you can show both live direct connection and also virtual lab through internet. You can show both. Replacement for ARCAD, so that KiCad, NGSpice, GSchema and so on, we have work going on. Okay. So lab migration project is this, where you have a lab that you are running in MATLAB. Because of that, you are not able to switch over to Scilab. Remember this way. So somebody can always come and say, look, I am doing my PhD thesis, I am doing PhD research. For that I need this particular toolbox that's available only in MATLAB. Now if I have to write the whole thing in Scilab, it will take me 6 months. my PhD will be postponed by 6 months, please allow me to use MATLAB. So we say, great, that's fine. That's fine. That's a valid complaint. So you might also have a company in which you already have license to MATLAB, and some software is helping your production. So if MATLAB doesn't work, then you may lose 1 day's production, 1 month's production. You may lose a lot of money. Please do use MATLAB by all means. But please don't use, you know, don't say, I'm a PhD student, I'm using MATLAB in my research. So I insist that MATLAB be used in second year signals and systems. Don't say that. For solving optimization problem, for solving differential equations, for doing matrix calculations, signal processing, plotting, all of that, entire undergraduate level, entire postgraduate level, all class work, Scilab is more than enough. If you need it for your research and you need some toolbox, please do it. But please don't inflict MATLAB on the unsuspecting undergraduate students. Let them use Scilab. It has all the things. There's everything. Is that clear? We are not saying that you must use MATLAB, you must use Scilab, don't use MATLAB ever. I'm not saying that. So you may have, you know, your research, you have to publish a paper, you have to do some urgent simulation, conference deadline is due, please use MATLAB. But please don't say that, so as a result, even the first year students should use MATLAB. Don't say that. If you do that, then you are happy, everybody is happy, people can use Scilab, right? They can all contribute to Scilab. Tomorrow, that same student can write the toolbox for you. The other one is the problems with open source software. There are one problem. Good documents are missing, lack of support, and hence it gives a wrong impression about the quality. MATLAB has excellent toolbox, I mean, support, help, books, manuals, all kinds of things. Okay, so to address this, what we did was, we did something, I'll skip the slides because it's going to take a lot of time. I'll summarize it in a few words, couple of minutes. We did a project called Textbook Companion. Okay, how many of you know about Textbook Companion? Scilab Textbook Companion, there are some of you, because some of your students have created Textbook Companions. So what we did was, we said we want to create lots of documentation, especially for our classroom teaching. So suppose I use signal processing book, let's say by Prokes. Okay, I want to use Scilab for that. So I said that let me solve all the worked out examples by Scilab and make that code freely available to everybody. We did a pilot 2 years ago. I had 6 students. There was a student from NIT Trichy. There was a student from BIT Ranchi. There was a student from Sri Mata Vaishnav Devi University, Jammu. And then we had 3 of our own students. Each of the students converted one textbook. Converted means code all the examples, worked out examples in Scilab, make sure the answer is the same. Because the answer is given, worked out example. We came up with a formula, one student, 1 month, one book. One student, 1 month, one book. Now we have more than 100 books. Students from all over the country have done. So in fact, I ask, you know, electrical engineering, how many books are there? Good textbooks. 5,000? How many students do we have? How many students do we have? How many good students we have? We have several thousands. We can finish them all in 1 month. So if you give that, then you don't need, I mean, of course, it's useful to have great looking manuals, but if you can solve all your problems, worked out examples in all your courses using Scilab, then can't you use Scilab? So the textbook companion project in Scilab has worked extremely well. The other one is Spoken Tutorial. Other documentation project is Spoken Tutorial, and you are going to use Spoken Tutorial after tea break to learn Scilab. But before that, we have our events team. Come.
Myself, Trupti More, and I'm here with my colleagues Sharda and Arjun. So as you know, I mean, we are given regions to work on. So today what I'll do is I'll give you a glimpse of Spoken Tutorial. Like what exactly we do and what we are looking for. Okay, so I'm sure you all have heard about Spoken Tutorial, right? So it's a big project, okay? It is funded by MHRD. So what we do is we conduct workshops. FOSS workshop, which is free and open source software. Okay, we conduct it in several colleges. So when I say that we conduct a workshop, it's not that we physically go to each and every college. Okay, and we conduct a workshop. It's not that way. We do it remotely. Okay, like we do it through video conferencing, through Skype. Okay, like there are so many colleges that we have already done workshops in. You won't believe, but you know, we have reached colleges in Jammu and Kashmir, as Sir said. You know, we have also done some workshops in Mizoram. So our reach out is you know, quite extensive. And as far as our project is concerned, we are very ambitious. And it's not that you know, we just want to do workshops and workshops and workshops. See, we want you all to you know, take it to your colleges as well. Okay, it shouldn't stop here. Okay, when I'm saying this, when I'm giving you all the information about our workshops, we want you to do workshops in your own college. We want it you know, to be learned by all the students. Okay, because the audience is large. See, I'll just tell you like what all workshops we are doing. I mean, you just got a lot of information about Scilab. Okay, so besides Scilab, we also run workshops on Linux. Linux, LaTeX, Python, PHP and MySQL. Yes. Someone just said, yeah. Okay, great, great. So you already oh, that's great. We want you to, you know, make use of it. We want you to promote it, help us in promotion. And you know, I mean, it's limitless, you can say. And when I say that we are working on this project, okay? And when I say that we are doing workshops, okay, it is just that we are showing you a way that this is how you can learn Scilab, or this is how you can learn Linux, okay? Because it's all about self-learning. If you go through our CD, okay, our spoken tutorial CD, you will see that there are, it's a very easy way of learning, first of all. And there are step-by-step guidelines given, okay? So all you have to do is you just have to go through all the tutorials, okay, and the guidelines. And you won't need a tutor besides you. I mean, it is that easy. You know, so it's, I mean, you will all wonder that since it is a FOSS, you know, it is free to download, free to use, then why should you learn it through spoken tutorial? But the beauty of our workshop is, you know, it is, you can learn it in a very easy way. It is very user-friendly, and as I said, you know, it is, I mean, there are step-by-step guidelines given. You know, so it is not just easy for you, but even for a student, you know, who is a first-time user. So what I'll do is, I mean, today I'll just take you through one small presentation, okay? And that way you will understand, like, what all we'll do in spoken tutorial. And as I said, you know, all you have to do is, you just have to show your interest, and we will take it from there. Okay, we will come to your workshop, we will do workshops. We'll come to your college and we'll do workshop. So, yeah, yeah, it is very much there. Oh, which server are you talking about? It should be, oh, okay. Then there might be some issue with the server. So there might be some problem with the server, but otherwise it's working well. See, that's the beauty. I mean, it's not restricted to a particular stream or particular, see, I'll tell you, the workshops are, you know, the duration is only 2 hours. But it is not that you will learn everything in 2 hours. Okay, we just show you a way. Okay, you will just go through several tutorials. So it depends on the person, it depends on the participant. Okay, if he already knows the software, or if he's like very, you know. Yes, yes, exactly. We have our tutorials in several languages, like Hindi, Hindi, Marathi. Yes, yes, even that is given. See, when we conduct workshop, okay, it is done through Skype. Okay, so the only requirement is Skype connection, yeah. Even internet is not required. I mean, once you have the CD with you, you know, you just need, and you need a headset, that's it. See, when the workshop is conducted, like suppose if you wish to have workshop in your college, yes, so we can definitely do it, you know, between 10 to 5, And that time, our people, our technical team would be there on Skype. So all you have to do is you
don't have few students
create your Skype ID,
what are you studying?
Share it with us, and we'll take it from there.
Engineering, arts, science, management, or commerce. What next? Either you will go for a job or you will opt for higher studies. So, to get recruited in a job or to get admission in higher studies, what will you need? You have to clear college exams. You will have to gain some experience in such an extracurricular activity that would highlight your leadership qualities, and you will need to acquire knowledge in some software. What if you get something extra? Would you like to learn some new software? Would you like to receive certificates from IIT Bombay? Would you like to gain experience in event management? So, we are here, the spoken tutorial team from IIT Bombay. We will let you know how to grab these extra achievements. Now, what are these extra achievements? Where are they? When to achieve them? And how? We will give you a training in software so that you can find jobs easily and get into higher studies. Can you name some software that is in the job market? Or any software that you will need when you go for higher studies? Let me name some. Python is a programming software much easier than C++. It is used in 3D animation and gaming industry. YouTube, NASA, Yahoo, and so on. Linux is an operating system free to download and use, almost virus proof and free from all licensing issues. 90% of the supercomputers run on Linux. PHP and MySQL is a complete package for web development. It is used for Facebook, Google, Wikipedia, and so on. LibreOffice is an office package similar to MS Office. It has all features of MS Office. It is widely used all over the world in countries like France, China, and Germany. It is suited for SMEs and in future in all GUI offices. LaTeX is a typesetting software, best option for any person interested in publishing in journals and any technical writing. Supports many templates, including IEEE, and excellent formatting facilities. Computational software, much similar to and possesses all features of MATLAB. Very useful for engineers and academia. We encourage you to switch to FOSS. You can learn them for free. You can get good jobs. This is a new article on benefits of FOSS. Why FOSS? It's free to download. It's free for use. No hassles of copyright or licensing. Easy to learn using spoken tutorials. We will teach you FOSS. We will teach you Linux, LaTeX, Scilab, Python, and PHP and MySQL. You will learn also these software through spoken tutorials. What is spoken tutorial? It is an audiovisual movie. It will make you learn from the basic level. Practice commands, solve assignments. You can learn software anytime, anywhere, and at any speed. Spoken tutorials is a unique way to learn. It has an audio component and a video component. You can learn at your own pace. It is like a live teacher. You can pause, rewind, and rehear the teacher. It is designed for a girl trying to learn a are being offered for free, as this project is funded by MHRD, Government of India. These workshops are held in individual college campuses. Duration of these workshops is only 2 hours. Online tests are conducted by IIT Bombay. IIT Bombay as part of these workshops. Here is the process. Get study material from IIT Bombay. Learn and practice some tutorials during tech workshop. Study rest of the tutorials using spoken tutorial after the workshop. Take a post-workshop test. Receive certificates. Certificates are awarded to both the participants and the organizers. You can organize self-workshops in your college. Connect to IITB. You can be a self-workshop ambassador and conduct workshops in your college. A self-workshop manager and conduct many workshops in your college, spanning single or multiple departments. A self-workshop promoter and conduct workshops and spread awareness in many colleges. You can also represent us in your college fest. These are some students from Sardar Patel Institute of Engineering, Mumbai. These are some of the comments from people across the country. These are news articles and not published by IIT Bombay. They are published by faculty members of KS Institute of Engineering and Technology, Maharashtra. Please write to IIT Bombay Spoken Tutorial Team for workshops in Northern, Eastern, Western and Central India. Contact Payal. For workshops in Mumbai and Maharashtra, contact Tripti. For workshops in Gujarat, contact Madhukriti. For workshops in South India, contact Shama Iyer.
So this was, this was a short glimpse of what we do. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask. Yeah? Sorry? Uh-huh. Right. See, what I'll do is I'll share our contact details with you all, okay? And please write to us, okay? We would love to do a workshop in your college, because as I said before, we want you to take this to your college. We want you all to pass on this to your students as well. Yeah, because as you all know, I mean, there are numerous benefits of FOSS. So we just want you to help us in promotion. So thanks a lot.
So instead of my talking about spoken tutorials, I thought our team should do that. So I conclude my talk here on open source software and Scilab. Open source efforts are not only idealistic, but also make economic and commercial sense. It has a potential to empower all Indian children to collaborate and make us a developed nation. IIT Bombay is working on several open source projects. We invite you to join us and also benefit by the fruits. Our project has been funded by NMEICT, Government of India.